world. It's pretty scary right now.
We live in a very, very uncertain time.
So we're fast-tracking the acquisition of two new long-range guided cruise missiles, the Joint Air-to-Surface Standoff Missiles and the Naval Strike Missile as part of the Guided Weapons and Explosive Ordnance Enterprise. They'll be on board Aussie fighter jets and frigates by 2024.
We also give ourselves the best chance of developing a sovereign industry.
As for the sudden urgency, well, there's an election on the horizon. Also, there's a potential threat on the horizon.
As the circumstances in the Indo-Pacific continue to deteriorate, we need to be realistic about what it is we're seeing.
I think he means China. From an unauthorised naval jaunt through Torres Strait in February to a secret military deal on the cards with the Solomon Islands, China's presence in our backyard has ramped up dramatically. With respective ranges of 900 and 185 kilometres, our new cruise missiles might encourage them to back off in a couple of years' time.
What the government is doing is in some ways filling a capability gap that it created itself. So this announcement reduces that gap from 2027 back to 2024. So it's a good thing, but essentially we're filling a gap.
As of right now, we don't have any long-range missile capability at all. And we just scrapped our $1.3 billion armed drone program last week.
I think most Australians, they'd be quite surprised to know that the Australian Defence Force does not have any armed drones.
For more than a decade, defence spending's been a ragged tapestry of budget blowouts, political pivots and scrapped contracts. Right, Emmanuel?
I don't think, I know.
So is our missile mission better late than never?
Ian McPhedran is a defence writer and author. He joins us now. Ian, China's more aggressive stance hasn't exactly come out of nowhere. A lot's been happening at the moment, but have we been caught out here?
Well, I don't think so. I mean, you know, we've all known that Xi Jinping is a dictator who wants to project China's power into the world. They're the second biggest economy on the planet, and they're acting as a powerful player. I mean, the only people talking about war with China are Peter Dutton and a couple of his mates. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, China has the right to project power and the right to build its military. What it doesn't have the right to do is do secret deals with Pacific Island nations to try and infiltrate what has traditionally been our part of the world, but also a peaceful part of the world. And we want to keep it that way. And hopefully, you know, we can get China to back off.
Well, Ian, if we're looking at just our artillery and our defence strategy, if we have a look at our recent history, we seem to be a little bit crap at that. So why are we, and how do we become less crap at it?
Well, you know, at the end of the day, successive governments have tried to make defence better and successive governments have failed. This government's no different. Defence has been pretty appalling at doing its acquisitions over the last two decades or so. And just last week, we learned that it's going to cost $5.5 billion to cancel the French submarine project. $5.5 billion. Now, that would fix the entire national aged care crisis. So I think defence has got a lot to answer for. But, you know, it also has to be a political issue, and defence ministers need to be very, very careful. You know, Theodore Roosevelt said in 1901, diplomacy is about speaking softly and carrying a big stick. At the moment, we're speaking loudly with a very little stick.
Ian, if strike capability is so important, why did we ditch the drones?
Well, the drones are a short range thing, Pete. They don't do the long range strike capability. You can use them, you know, within the battlefield, the battle space, if there was a fight going on. But to actually send them out into another country or out into the ocean and get them to do a long range strike, it's not what they're made for. So these missiles are long range missiles, along with the Tomahawks that will be arming our new submarines whenever we get them. And they are long-range strike capabilities, the ones that really do make potential enemies sit up and take notice, whereas the armed drones are for short-range activities such as Afghanistan and Iraq and, you know, desert warfare type situation. And they are very effective, and we should have some armed drone capability. And I don't really understand why they cancelled that project, to be honest.
Ian, China seems to be very much the priority, but do you think that events in Ukraine are changing our thinking, or should be?
Absolutely. You know, what Ukraine is showing us is that when a big country decides that it's going to take on a small country, it needs much more force and much bigger forces than what the Russians have thought they could do in Ukraine. They've had their backsides kicked in Ukraine. And the other thing that it teaches us is that heavy armour has limited capability when you've got anti-armour missiles, like the Javelin, the shoulder-fired missiles. You've got one man with a shoulder-fired missile taking out tanks with, you know, half a dozen guys in the tank. And it's just been Russian tanks littered all over the battlefield. So there's been lots of lessons in the Ukraine. And the biggest lesson, I think, is that for big aggressive powers, say, like China, if you're going to take over a little country, say, like Australia, little in terms of population, then you need a lot more firepower than they've got.
Do you have to give China that advice on national television, Ian?
Sorry about that.
Yeah. So I think sure they'll probably figure that out without our intervention here tonight.
They're always listening.
I think so, mate. Yeah.
Thanks for your time, Ian. Thanks for joining
us. Pleasure. Thanks, guys.